Welcome again. In the previous video of this module, we have talked about business aspects of autonomous electric vehicles. Today, we will discuss advanced business aspects of smart charging. Before we dive into the economics, let's start with an understanding of what we mean with smart charging. It's a broad topic, and many examples of it are mentioned by companies, researchers, and media. Though, in general, it can be defined by the alteration of the EV's charge cycle with the goal to better integrate it as a load on the grid. This way, we can prevent possible grid issues and still maintain the mobility requirements of the customer. Now that we know what we, in general, mean with smart charging, we can discuss why we would do this. Let me give you a hint. It has to do with stimulating the uptake of EVs. To make an EV more attractive to a customer, we can reduce the total cost of ownership by reducing the cost of charging. Let's consider the average case of an EV charging cost. We see that based on driving roughly 15,000 kilometers per year at average consumption of 5 kilometers per kilowatt hour, and an electricity price of 20 cents per kilowatt hour, the annual charging cost will be around 600 euro. If we can reduce these costs through smart charging and still ensure that the user can use his car the way he wants to, we might save hundreds of euros per year. This can make the choice for any person to choose for an electric vehicle easier. However, there are also other stakeholders involved for whom EV charging can become a problem and thus leading to costs. It would be of value to ensure that EV charging does not become an issue. So I've explained the definition of smart charging and how it can help us in the energy transition. However, I can understand you are still curious to know what we can actually do to create value for the energy system. In other words, what markets can we tap into? This is what I will show you in the following slides. For a short recap, in smart charging, what we can do is influence the charging time, the charging power, and the direction of charging. Now I will explain five main strategies of smart charging in more detail. I will show you how value is created for various stakeholders. The first of the five strategies is local load balancing. Imagine an office where we aim to charge multiple newly acquired EVs. However, in most buildings, the grid connection was never designed for this. It might happen that these cars are charged around the time that the office demands peak power from the grid. Upgrading this grid connection will not only require an investment, it will also increase the yearly cost charged by the grid operator. What we can do is tap into the flexibility provided by the fact that not everyone needs to charge immediately or constantly with full power. We can apply two smart charging strategies. The first is to decide to charge the EVs later or with less power, to reduce the possible peaks on the grid connection. Second is to divide the power to the vehicles in a smart way. This way we can charge EVs, but still use the current grid connection. This way we do not need to invest to reinforce it, and we can save thousands of euros. The second possibility is smart charging for DSO. There is a clear similarity to the previous example. We want to charge our EVs without overloading the local grid. In some places, grids are old and are already in danger of overloading. Imagine an inner city street where many people have an electric vehicle and there are many on-street chargers connected to the low voltage electricity grid system. This grid is operated by the distribution system operator or district net operator. Again, since EV charging creates a substantial load, there is the danger of overloading the grid cables and transformers. So to accommodate the growing amount of EVs, but prevent costly investments in grid infrastructure, we can choose to incentivize smart charging. For example, if electricity prices are linked to the time of use, EVs could charge in times of low electricity prices. This will reduce charging costs for the user, and the DSO can save tens of thousands of euros on a neighborhood grid. Strategy 3 deals with participating in energy markets. Based on supply and demand, the price of energy will vary during the day. Smart charging in this context means changing the charging cycle according to the electricity price in order to minimize charging costs. This can be done based on the spot price in the day-ahead market and the intraday trading market. It also allows us to better match the EV charging with renewable energy production on a regional or national scale. Strategy 4 is balancing services. This deals with creating value for the transmission system operator. This party is responsible for high voltage transport of electricity through a country and across its borders. To keep this grid stable, it needs to maintain the grid frequency at a certain value. All across Europe, this is 50 Hertz. Therefore, balancing markets have been constructed where actors get paid to assist the TSO in maintaining the grid frequency. These are the primary, secondary, and tertiary reserve markets. However, names can be different in different countries. Back to how it works. Well, the grid frequency can be kept stable by changing either supply or demand. By performing smart charging, EVs can influence the electricity demand and thus influence the frequency. This allows EV drivers to receive money from the TSO for providing this service. This way, electric car drivers can earn several hundreds of euros per year. The last strategy is V2G services. By not only changing the charging time and power, but also being able to send energy back to the grid, more value per vehicle can be created. This form of smart charging will be dealt with in the next video. On this slide, we see the various energy markets. In this example of the Netherlands, although this has been some specifics, the structure will be similar in most countries. It shows how supply of electricity is exactly matched with demand. This needs to be the case for our grid to be in balance. The closer we get to the actual time, so the more to the right side of the picture we go, the more precise the balancing becomes, and so the greater the value of the service. So we've seen what's possible, but why is this not being done on a large scale yet? Well, there are several reasons for this, but to name a few, let me start with saying that for the case of the DSO, there currently is not a real market structure in place where EVs get paid for smart charging. However, pilot projects are done in multiple areas around the globe to develop and test this. For the case of the national energy and balance markets, we see that the entry level into these markets is high due to strict regulations and large-scale requirements. This means it is difficult for new parties that lack experience and skill to enter this market. And more specifically, we see that net metering and feed-in tariffs lower the value of local use of, for example, solar energy, because this can be fed into the grid for an attractive price. This means that financially it might be more attractive to send the solar power into the grid instead of using it to charge the cars. And let me end this lecture by showing you two images. I will not dive into these here. You will have time to review these after the lecture. These figures will show you what the value chain of EV charging looks like and which companies are involved in which part. And with that, I would like to conclude this lecture on the business aspects of smart charging. Thank you.